Father, your word says, what shall I render unto the Lord for all his benefits towards me? There is nothing any soul can offer adequately, sufficiently for all the benefits, the blessings we have been enjoying by way of protection, by way of preservation, by way of guidance, by way of leading, by way of provision and supplies, by way of healing and health. Father, there's no limit to thanking you for the blessings. We thank you, Father, for your grace that created us in your own image and likeness. Your grace that enabled us to key into your grace of salvation. We are now called your children. We are your chosen. Father, we thank you. We worship you. We adore you for the benefits of Calvary that we are partaking from day to day, from week to week, from month to month, from year to year. Father, in the name of Jesus, accept our thanks and praises in Jesus' name. Father, you have brought us to the beginning of a new day. Father, a new day started with you will be a day of peace, a day of progress, a day of prosperity, a day of healing, a day of health. Father, I pray and ask you, Father, that as we go into this morning devotion, you accept us and bless us and take all the glory in Jesus' name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. This morning, before we go into the teaching, I'm going to sing from a song titled Another Year. Another year is dawning. A path unknown, a path untried. To fill me with foreboding, and I know guide. But he who has walked with me all through the yesteryear, whatever may be tied, has promised to be near. Another year is dawning, a path unknown, untried. To fill me with foreboding, but I have no hand to guide. But he who walks beside me all through the yesteryear, whatever may be tied, me has brought means to be near. Another year with Jesus, had then no dread I know. His love is ever precious, however the winds may blow. And when the storm is fiercest, in him my soul may rest. I am found sweet peace and comfort upon his loving breast. Another year to trust. Yes, I can trust him still. Whoever yet has paid me as high as such is will. His rod and staff he gave to be my strength and stay. The lake in is along the homeward way. Another year to serve into labor for him here. In what the shadows lay, me and night is drawing near. not he'll call me to lay my sick goodbye. Oh, may I then be fair. Oh, why now the moments fly. Another year to love him whom I have lost so long. Another year to praise him in glad triumphant song. Whatever the future hold, death of sorrow, toil, or pain, His precious love endure, rest forevermore the same. Another year with Jesus I thank thee, Lord, today for thy unfailing presence along life's rugged way. Guide me, O blessed Redeemer, teach me to do thy will. And thine own perfect purpose in me today. Praise the Lord. We now move to the morning devotion passage for today. We shall be taking our passage from the book of Luke, chapter 19. We are reading from verse 1 through to verse 10. And I read, "And Jesus entered and passed through Jericho, and behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which was the chief among the publicans, and he was rich." Verse 3, "And he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press, because he was little of stature." Verse 4, "And he ran before and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was to pass that way." Verse 5, "And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him, and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide at thy house." And verse 6, "And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully." Verse 7, "And when they saw it, they all murmured, saying that he was gone to be guest with a man that is a sinner." Verse 8, "And Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold." Verse 9, "And Jesus says unto him, This day is salvation come to this house, for so much as he also is a son of Abraham." Verse 10, "For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost." The topic of our devotion this morning is won by love. Love is the medium by which we can reach out to the perishing world and win them unto our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us in the book of Romans chapter 3, verse 23. And it says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." From the day that Adam and Eve fell, sin entered the world. And we are all descendants of Adam and Eve. And because we are all descendants of Adam and Eve, we have inherited sin. So that's why the Bible says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." And God, in His marvelous love, does not want any man, any woman, any boy to die, perish, and go to hell. What did He do? John chapter 3, verse 16. There we see the love of God the Father. He didn't want anyone to die, perish, and go to hell. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now that was what Adam and Eve lost in the Garden of Eden. They have direct access to everlasting life. But because of sin, they lost it. But God now sent His only begotten Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to this world, and now put a rider that whosoever believeth in Jesus Christ should not perish, but have everlasting life. That is what He has done for me. That is what He has done for the whole world. But let's look at another verse of the Bible. Ezekiel chapter 18, verses 4 and 20. There we see that the soul that sinneth, it shall die. That is the verdict of God upon man from the days of Adam and Eve to date. And it's not negotiable. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. And I just make reference to Romans chapter 6, verse 23. There we see that, you know, the wages of sin is death, but the love of God comes through salvation of our Lord Jesus Christ. The wages of sin is death, but the sacrifice is through faith in the atonement of Jesus Christ at the cross of Calvary. And we see revelation of love of God the Father. Before the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, God Himself has said that He doesn't want any man, any woman to die and perish and go to hell. So we now see that in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18. Isaiah chapter 1 verse 18 says, "Come," it's an invitation, "and let us reason together." When you come to God, He wants you to reason with Him. How do you reason with Him? He knows already, He's omniscient, that we have all sinned. But He now wants you on your own to tell Him, to acknowledge that you are a sinner. "Come and let us reason together." That is God inviting sinners to Himself. Says the Lord, "Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be what? They shall be as white as snow." That is, after a sinner has repented of his sins and accepted Jesus Christ, God will not purge the sinner. He cleanses the sinner. He cleans the sinner and makes him as white as snow. He said, "Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool." God has the power to clean, to cleanse, to purge, to wash, and make sinner as snow, as white as snow. But there must be that response. So if you are listening to this Bible study and you have not given your life to our Lord Jesus Christ, I am now echoing to you what God has said. He said, "Come now and let us reason together." That's for God to say you should come. He doesn't want you to perish and go to hell. And my counsel and perhaps to you now, that you respond to our to God's call, and don't hide anything. whatever you have done by way of sin, by way of lying, by way of cheating, by way of fornication, by way of adultery, by way of stealing, tell him. He has a record already, but you have to personally, you know, confess unto him. And if you have already accepted that, heeded that call, I congratulate you. So, we see in the passage we read, let's go to Luke again from verse 9 to 10. Luke chapter 19, verses 5 to 10. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said unto him, Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was a sinner, but he was very rich, was a custom man, so he had all the money that people needed. But he realized that he was a sinner, and when he heard that Jesus Christ was passing by, he ran and climbed a sycamore tree because it was of a small stature, so that Jesus Christ could see him. So, and he did. What was he looking for? He was looking for salvation, to be able to repent of his sins and accept Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior. So, and when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him. You are under my voice this morning, wherever you are. Jesus Christ will see you, and we meet you at your point of need in Jesus' name. And said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste, come down, for today I must abide at thy house. And what did he do? Verse 6, and he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. So a sinner should joyfully receive Jesus Christ into his life because he is the Savior of the world. And now look at verse 7. And when they saw him, these are people around, you know, unbelievers, sinners around. What did they do? They all murmured, saying that he was going to be guest with a man that is a sinner. Yes, he was a sinner. But a lesson we are learning there is this. For me, for you as a believer, to win souls unto Christ, you can't distance yourself from them. You have to get closer to them. And you don't do the things that make them to be sinners, you don't do. But through your closeness with them, you'll be able to win their attention and you preach the word of God to them. So that's what the Sadducees were complaining about. And Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, behold, Lord, half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore them fourfold. This man has accepted Jesus Christ, and he has done what you call in the Bible language, restitution. He was a custom man. He has taken things by force, deceiving them, cheating, and now he made his restitution. What's restitution? Restitution is making right all the wrongs that we have done other people. That's what he has done here. And if you are born again, you have to make your restitution. Whatever lies you have told, whatever you have taken from your place of work, whatever you have done to deceive people, you have to make restitution. Restitution is a step we take after salvation to be able to convince God the Father, God's Son, God's Holy Ghost, that we are now indeed, you know, their children. And Jesus said unto the man, this day is salvation come to this house. And that language is equally applicable to every born again man. The moment you repent of your sins and accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ comes to live inside of you. And you too will be living inside of him. That's why I said, this day is salvation come to this house. For as much as he is also a son of Abraham. You know, a believer, after repenting of his sins, accepted Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ lives in him, and he lives in Jesus Christ. That's what he told us, and we're not reading that. In John chapter 15, verse 5, he said, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, a sinner cannot abide in Jesus Christ, and I in him, he will not abide in a sinner. The same goeth forth and bringeth forth much fruit. Look at the conclusion there. He said, and without me, you can do nothing. Fellow listeners, our life, our time, our talents and treasure, everything comes from God. But of all that God has given us, the most important is our salvation. And we should treasure it. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which is lost. So, our Lord Jesus Christ came to this world, and to be able to receive him, as we have seen Zacchaeus did, so every sinner should do, to be able to repent of his sins and accept Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior. So, then reaching out to hopeless sinners. You have accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. That's very good. But there are people around us who are carrying the guilt and condemnation of their sins upon their life. They don't know what to do to be able to get saved. But you know what to do. And that is why our Lord Jesus Christ gave believers the Great Commission, saying, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. That is a commandment to me and to you. For those who are confused, they committed various types of sins, and they think that they cannot receive forgiveness. What are we to do? We are to start by relating with them. You cannot preach to somebody with whom you are fighting. So the starting point is friendship. In your house, if you want to see somebody that is a sinner, if you are fighting that person, you will not even have the moral courage to go and preach to the person. So the starting point of reaching out to the perishing world and sinners around us is to befriend them, not the language of the world, to show love to them, so that if they are in any difficulty, even before you preach to them, if they are having challenges in their life, assist them. What are you doing when you do that? You are laying a foundation to be able to preach unto them. So, let's imagine that you have somebody in your house, just give them birth to a new baby. That's a very good news. Do whatever you can, help to birth the baby, and continue to encourage her as a mother. Or, if it's a young man, and you are privileged, is looking for a job, and you know of a vacancy somewhere, assist them, relate with them. By doing that, you are softening their heart to be able to listen to you when you preach to them. The number three thing you have to do is that you care for them. You find that somebody living in the same house with you have need of something, and you have that thing. When you begin to touch that life and do like that, then an opportunity will come where you say that, well, it may even be the one that, well, I can see that your own life is different from some other people have been saying. What's the difference? It is Jesus Christ. That is an opening to be able to preach the gospel. So if we want to be able to win souls for Christ, number one, we have to show love through friendship. Number two, we have to care for them. And number three, we have to pray and commit their souls to Christ, because you know the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. You have to pray that God will soften their heart so that when they hear the gospel, they'll be able to accept the word of God and surrender their life to our Lord Jesus Christ. Then after that, the fourth thing that we have to do is we share the gospel with them. The gospel is the word of God. Through the gospel, we introduce Jesus Christ as the Savior of the world. And when we do that prayerfully, God will touch them and God will save them in Jesus' name. So, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ laid down his life for sinners to be saved. And we are the agents And we can only do it in line with the title of the Bible study this morning, by love. And that's what our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ did. He knew no sin. He did no sin. He's holy. He's righteous. But what did he do? He came to this world and died. As in that verse of the Bible I referred to before, Ezekiel chapter 18, verses 4 and 20, God says, the soul that sinneth, he shall die. But as an act of love, he sent Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, who died for our sins. And through faith in his atonement at the cross of Calvary, we have salvation. But it is only through me, through you, those of us who have accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, that these people can know the gospel. It's a great assignment. Others have done it. For us to come into where we are now, I pray that the grace for us to reach out to others and preach to them and get them to accept Jesus Christ, God will grant unto us in Jesus' name. Let us close our eyes as we go to the Lord in prayer. This morning, the topic is won by love. And we have seen the example in the life of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray together. Almighty Father, we thank you. We worship you. We adore you. You have demonstrated that you are a God of love by sending your only begotten Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to die for the sins of the world. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ himself also laid down his life, the second person, not in the Godhead. No one could have taken his life from him. But in order that we might be saved and reconciled unto you, he laid down his life. What a show of love. What a show of kindness. What a show of compassion. Father, accept our thanks and praises in Jesus' name. Father, your grace of salvation has been made available to all humanity. But it is only those who repent of their sins that can key into it. Father, we are praying and asking, Father, we cannot save souls. It is the prerogative of God the Father, God's Son, and God the Holy Ghost. But we are praying and asking, Father, that you will use all the power at your disposal to prepare souls ready for our harvest in Jesus' name. And as we preach to them, the grace to be able to see Jesus Christ as the Savior of the world, humble themselves, repent of their sins, and accept him as their Lord and Savior. Father, grant unto them in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, for those who have already saved. Father, the grace to be able to continue to run the Christian race as we should run it and end up your kingdom in heaven. Father, grant unto us in Jesus' name. Father, there are many who accepted Jesus Christ but have backslided. Father, have mercy upon them, O Lord, according to your loving kindness and tender mercies. Father, speak unto them, grant them the grace to run to you for restoration. And as they do, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I pray that you restore them back to faith. And as you do, grant them the grace to go and sin no more. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen.